Our next story is about a few brave men who took part in one of the crucial turning points in World War II, the Battle of Britain.
We invited one of the few, Air Commodore Christopher Mount, or Micky as he's known, to visit three aviation museums with Battle of Britain collections. He starts at Duxford, where the present still echoes with the past. Today, it's part of the Imperial War Museum. If this Mark 9 Spitfire being flown by its owner Stephen Gray doesn't look quite right, that's because the famous elliptical wing tips have been chopped off to give it more agility at low level. Everything else is there, including the unmistakable snarl of the Rolls-Royce Merlin engine. An evocative sound and sight, and for us a chance to reunite man and machine. For the first time in nearly 50 years, we returned Micky Mount to his 1940 workplace.
There's a curious situation whereby you find yourself, first of all, surrounded by aeroplanes, some friendly and some foe. You make your attack, and then, quite suddenly, the whole sky seems to be empty. When I see aircraft in the museums, it brings back a lot of memories, nostalgic memories, most of which are very pleasant, I think. It's nice to see that the times gone before us are remembered.
At Duxford, I found a lot to remember, and like some of the younger visitors, quite a lot to discover too. This is a museum for anyone who simply likes being in the company of aeroplanes. Unlike the abandoned TSR-2, not all the aircraft are military. Duxford has a big collection of British airliners, including one of the four Concorde built for test flying. In its day, this one flew faster and higher than any other Concorde. But back to the Battle of Britain. This year, Duxford opened this very faithful reconstruction of their wartime operations room. Five squadrons were controlled from here. At the Royal Air Force Museum in North London, the displays are all static. The museum at Hendon rarely traces the history of aviation through more than 60 aircraft, most of which bore the RAF roundel at one time or another. I found much of my own flying career on show here. I learned on an Avro 504, you did everything at 60 miles an hour, and I ended up in one of these, a supersonic Lightning. Nearby is one of history's more vainglorious quotations, appropriately inscribed on the nose of a Lancaster bomber, which alone made nearly 140 raids into the Reich territory. Next to it, an American flying fortress and an ancestor, the Vickers Vimy.
One thing I like about this museum is the importance it gives to radar, because without radar, we would have had to have used standing patrols. And over a period of time, that would have been quite impracticable.
Those early radar sets are part of Hendon's latest exhibit, the Battle of Britain Experience. It begins with the ominous drums of the Hitler Youth. Hendon has a unique collection of wartime German aircraft.
In the battle, the bombers were the targets, but the fighters, the ME-109, were the adversary. Cannon firing out of the nose and two cannons in the wings.
The Hurricane, which I flew later in the war, had 8 machine guns in the wings, same as the Spitfire. The sturdy Hurricane was the more stable gun platform of the two. Personally, I preferred to fly the Spitfire. The last museum I visited was the Kent Battle of Britain Museum at Hawkinge, near Folkestone. It has its gift shop and souvenirs, but it is quite different from either Duxford or Hendon. It is the most human. From the wreckage of this Messerschmitt, the pilot survived. He is a regular visitor today. The enemy was ideology, not individuals, and the battle was destructive. Most of the exhibits are pieces of aeroplane, instruments read and controls handled.
It came home to me when I came across this exhibit showing Willie Rose Morehouse, a great friend of mine, who was unfortunately shot down on the 6th of September 1940.
Most of what is here bears the chips and dents of authenticity. Hawkins was the wartime RAF station nearest to occupied France, and the buildings date from those days. The fact that it doesn't have the elaborate tableaus, or, it seems, even a place for all its exhibits, nor the slick presentation of the bigger museums, only adds to its character. You can see the difference between the German cannon shells and the British machine gun bullets. They are part of the history of the battle. The flying suits and the pilot's possessions are part of the humanity. You get a vivid idea of both the scale and the intensity of the battle from Hawkinge. Pretty well all of this wreckage was recovered from the countryside of one county, Kent, on which it was scattered in a little less than 3 months. Hawkinge tells the story through models and photographs, old magazines, newspapers, debris. Its full-sized aircraft are props from the film, The Battle of Britain. Of the three museums, it is this proud little amateur that is closest in spirit to those days.
None of us at that time thought we were doing anything out of the ordinary. It was just another phase in the war. I am now totally amazed at the interest shown in the battle. We were, you know, very ordinary people.